Hello, everyone, and welcome to the Fairfax Scene. I'm your host, Rachel Roth. In this edition, Civil War author Hampton Newsome will describe his book, Richmond Must Fall, which covers the Richmond-Petersburg campaign.
What we're talking about here, particularly in October 1864, are these battles that involve very famous leaders that will be familiar to you, the well-known units, but the events themselves are relatively unknown, and that's what drew me to them, because no one had written a book about these fairly significant battles in the fall of 1864 outside of Richmond. Well, let's talk about the Petersburg campaign. So sometimes it's called the Richmond-Petersburg campaign or the Siege of Petersburg. And it occurred at near the end of the war. And it basically, Ulysses S. Grant, Robert E. Lee are commanding the armies, and they're outside of Richmond and Petersburg for 10 months. It's this huge, sprawling campaign. And it dwarfs many of the other campaigns in its breadth and length. The campaigns like Gettysburg that were, you know, only a couple of weeks. Petersburg here we're talking about months and months. And compared to other operations, it's relatively understudied. And my experience is that when I talk to people about it, even to people that are very into the Civil War, very interested in the Civil War, it's not something they have a whole lot of knowledge about. And there hasn't been a lot of treatment in books about it until recently. So in 1864, Grant is basically in charge of the entire Union war effort. And he coordinates a multi-pronged offensive in different parts of the South. So you've got Sherman at Atlanta. And in Virginia, you've got the Army of the Potomac outside Fredericksburg. Grant goes along, is basically puts his headquarters with the Army of the Potomac. And in the spring of 1864, you have these series of battles that you may have heard of, the Wilderness, Spotsylvania, North Anna. These are these series of battles that bring the armies down to Richmond. And when they get to Richmond, there's some initial attacks. Grant crosses the James here. There's some initial attacks at Petersburg that aren't successful, and things settle down to for a very long campaign beginning in June of 1864. Petersburg is important because it's an important rail hub connecting the South to the Virginia to the South. It helps connects Richmond to the South in a way. There's one other railroad that connects Richmond to the South. So it's a very, it's a vital position for Lee's army. For the Union forces, Petersburg provides a perfect line of supply for them. They have their supply base at this point here called City Point. Richmond is the kind of the political nerve center of the South, and its loss would be devastating to the Confederate cause. And so during the campaign, we've got Union forces here at Petersburg, and over the course of the summer of 1864, they open a new front outside of Richmond. There's a bridgehead created at this place called Deep Bottom. And so for much of the campaign, you've got forces outside Richmond and forces outside Petersburg. And that's why we generally call it the Richmond-Petersburg campaign. At Petersburg, you've got this dizzying maze of forts and trenches and covered ways and military roads. The earthworks are east of the city and west of the city. And it's just amazing the miles and miles of trenches that are dug. In some places, they're very, very close. It's very dangerous for the men in the trenches. Snipers, mortars, they're a constant source of danger. It's just not a pleasant place to be. A quote during October from one of the Confederate soldiers, he writes home and he says, "The water here is very bad. We have little wells dug along the ditches, but the water is muddy and full of frogs, and the men suffer for it." And it's not a great place for the people in Petersburg either. Beginning in June, there's some artillery shelling from the Union batteries into Petersburg. Many of the citizens flee to the countryside. The Union army at Petersburg, Grant is in charge. And there are two armies. We've got the Army of the Potomac under George Meade and the Army of the James under Benjamin Butler. Meade is generally outside Petersburg. Butler is outside Richmond for much of the campaign. Grant, throughout the campaign, especially in the summer and into the fall, he's trying many different combinations of movements, offenses, in order to take Petersburg and Richmond. And Grant is generally viewed as someone who's unflappable, persistent, and at Petersburg, it's no different. Every month or so, he tries a different offensive, and he varies the location, the strength, the intensity of his advances. And sometimes they're multi-pronged attacks in different places, sometimes single attacks. Perhaps the most famous one is his third offensive that most people have heard of, and that's the crater battle, where the Union forces at Petersburg try to go straight through the Confederate trenches by detonating a mine under the trenches. It ends and doesn't end very well for the Union attack. There's a very strong Confederate counterattack that stops it. So basically, through the summer at Petersburg, Grant, there's no overwhelming victory. There's some steady progress that he makes, but he's yet to conjure up a really successful plan. For Robert E. Lee, this is a difficult time in the war for him. The Confederacy is shrinking. There are fewer areas of supplies, fewer areas to get men to fill the ranks. Wilmington is essentially really the only port. Sherman is a threat at Atlanta. And at Petersburg, he is tied down. He has few men. He has very long lines to cover. And he can't be everywhere to command in person and make decisions. And so it's very difficult for him. There are kind of two ways to look at the Petersburg campaign and Robert E. Lee and the kind of the hopes for the Confederacy and what impact the Petersburg campaign had. To many, the stalemate at Petersburg spells doom for Lee because it binds his forces to trenches and prevents him from fighting in open ground. And he says in the summer, he says, well, if we are pinned down at Petersburg, it'll just be a mere question of time. And in post-war interviews with his staff officers, he basically told them that he believed that the Richmond lines were ultimately not defensible, and what he really wanted to do was to get into the interior and draw Grant away from that supply source, from the rivers. Lee felt that once he had him in the interior, he had a better chance of defeating him. The alternative view, though, these earthworks may have actually prolonged the life of the Confederacy and offered the best chance for victory. Because the strong defenses, they blunted Union advances, and they spared rebel strength. At Petersburg, Lee is a very aggressive commander. He's always seeking to take the initiative, and he is not happy about this defensive position he's in at Richmond and Petersburg. And he tells one of his corps commanders, A.P. Hill, in June, he says, the time has arrived, in my opinion, when something is more is necessary than adhering to lines and defensive positions. We shall be obliged to go out and prevent the enemy from selecting such positions as he chooses. A.P. Hill, who commanded many of the troops at Petersburg, was ill for much of the campaign, so Lee had to rely on his division commanders, and he had some excellent division commanders there, William Mahone at Petersburg, Charles Field up at Richmond. He also had Henry Heath, who was a very capable commander and performed well at Petersburg. These commanders, they have tactical success throughout the summer. The Jerusalem Plank Road in June, the crater, as I mentioned, in July, the Weldon Railroad and Ream Station in August. And they fail to blunt kind of the steady progress that Grant makes, but they also prevent Grant from having any spectacular progress. This gets us to the most important event of 1864, and that is the presidential election. It's crucial to the war's outcome. A Lincoln victory would essentially seal the Confederacy's fate because it would ensure a vigorous prosecution of the war. His opponent is George McClellan, who was once commander of the Army of the Potomac. His own party has a peace platform, basically calling for negotiations with the South. McClellan distances himself from that, but it's not really clear exactly what happens if McClellan wins. In the Army, there's very strong support for Lincoln. One soldier says, do you think it's possible for soldiers to labor as we have labored, to march as we've marched, and to fight as we have fought? And when on the point of reaping the benefit of our labors and sufferings, vote for a party which would give up everything. Confederate leaders, they understood what was at stake. Davis, Confederate President Davis, goes around in the fall giving speeches. In one of them, he says, "Victory in the field is the surest element of strength to a peace party. Let us win." At the end of August, everything changes when Sherman takes Atlanta. It buoys Lincoln. It decreases the war weariness that we're talking about. And that's where we find ourselves as we go into the fall of 1864 and the Petersburg campaign. And Grant now needs to decide, well, what am I going to do? Am I going to just wait for the election, or am I going to continue to launch offenses? If I lose badly, is that going to hurt Lincoln in the election? Well, Grant goes ahead and attacks and continues to conduct operations. He launches an offensive in late September. He extends his lines beyond this railroad here and outside of Richmond. He takes a key Confederate stronghold called Fort Harrison. And so he has, once again, steady progress. This offensive greatly concerns Lee. His aide, Walter Taylor, says that Lee was more worried at this failure than I've ever seen him under similar circumstances. So that brings us into October. So Lee, with this concern about losing Fort Harrison, he decides to launch an offensive. He holds a council of war at his headquarters at the Chaffin Farm, and President Davis even comes down from Richmond, and they plan an offensive outside of Richmond. So here we have, this is just a blow up of this. Got Richmond here, the James coming down here, the Confederate lines are here, and Butler, who has taken Fort Harrison, now has this position here. And basically what Lee decides to do is to conduct a two-division, a fairly large-scale attack against Butler's right flank, which is kind of unprotected. You can see his line here, and there's this space here. Butler has his cavalry up here at Johnson's Farm, and Lee plans to sweep through Johnson's Farm and hopefully get behind the Union lines and take Fort Harrison back. The Union cavalry swept from Johnson's Farm. Lee gets to the New Market Road. And at the New Market Road, the Union batteries have a duel with Confederate batteries. The Confederate batteries are here. You can see Lee's troops lining up here for an attack on the New Market Road here. It's a disaster for Lee, and the decisive factor are the repeating rifles that the Union troops have. Butler rushes the 10th Corps here to this position. There are no trenches here. It's an open fight, but the Spencer repeating rifle devastates Lee's brigades here. It's Charles Field's division. Hoke's division is here. Hoke's division does an attack. Lots of casualties, and so this offensive is does not go well for Lee. And it turns out being pretty much his last offensive of the war. Even years after the war, Field would complain about Hoke and why Hoke didn't move. Stories in the newspaper said, well, Hoke was standing next to Lee, and Lee said, I don't want you to attack because you're the only thing standing between Butler and Richmond. And I think that's probably reasonable. But the fact that Field didn't realize what Hoke was supposed to do and what Hoke did, the reasons for it, just suggests that there's not a lot of communication going on. After that, the Confederates, they figure out that the trench line around Richmond is very unorganized. There are little pieces here and there, and so they build this line here. Porter Alexander, it's actually his idea. He's the artillery chief of the 1st Corps. He talks to the chief engineer in Richmond, and they lay this out. Benjamin Butler's pickets discover the line. Butler decides to conduct a reconnaissance. The reconnaissance is conducted on October 13th. This is sometimes called 2nd Darbytown Road. They get the information they need. But then in the middle of the afternoon, someone finds what they think is a gap in the line, and they go ahead and launch a brigade-sized attack. It turns out it's not a gap at all, and there are many, many casualties from this. And so this kind of adds to a long list of failures that he has during the war. He's kind of the quintessential political general. Many view him as militarily incompetent. Unusual appearance. There's this quote from Mark Twain, that the forward part of Butler's bald skull looks raised like a water blister. He is dismally and drearily homely, and when he smiles, it is like the breaking of a hard winter. And so Butler, he's a complicated guy. He's arrogant, obnoxious. He is a military novice. At the same time, he's very smart, creative. He has a lot of unconventional ideas. Some of them work. He's also an untiring advocate of the black troops, the United States Color Troops, as they call them, the USCTs. And he used them in all aspects of his operation, and he ensured they had good medical care. At the beginning of the war, he's the one who coined the term contraband. When the slaves self-emancipated and came into the Union lines early in the war, when the Union policy on emancipation was still kind of evolving, Butler said, well, these are contraband of war, and so the slaves remained in the Union lines. I found, especially during these operations, you know, there are things that Butler does well, and I think it's important to recognize that. What happens with Butler here, the day before he conducts that reconnaissance on the Darbytown Road that doesn't go very well, he gets reports that some of the captured USCTs have been, that the Confederates are putting them to work digging the Confederate lines outside of Richmond. And Butler is furious about this, and he gathers affidavits from deserters, and he sends a complaint to the Confederate officials, and he says, this is a practice justified by no rule of war or claim heretofore made by the Confederate authorities. And Butler does more than just write that letter. He retaliates, and he takes Confederate prisoners, and he places them at a place called Dutch Gap, where he is trying to shorten the James River, essentially. And it's a huge construction project, and it's within the range of the Confederate batteries. And he places the Confederate prisoners there, and he lets everyone know he's done that. And Grant approves of this. And Lee, in turn, retaliates, or at least begins to. He orders his men to build a pen that is under the range of the Union batteries and to put federal prisoners into that area. So this controversy starts winding up. There's an exchange of correspondence between Grant and Lee. Lee writes Grant this long memo about Confederate policy on this issue, and he says that prisoners that were identified as slaves will be put back into slavery, essentially. But he said that all of the black Union prisoners not identified as property of Confederate citizens would be treated as prisoners of war and not be subject to labor. There was a lot of confusion, Confederate confusion about this policy. There are memos in the records that show that, in fact, some of the captured USCTs were put on to work on the Confederate lines, even though they were identified as free men. Grant replies to Lee. He says, I have nothing to do with this discussion of the slavery question. And he says, it's my duty to protect all persons received into the Army of the United States, regardless of color or nationality. But Grant, given Lee's stated position, Grant kind of lets the controversy die, but it's an interesting window into what is the fundamental issue underlying the war. So after the Dutch Gap affair, Grant wants to conduct another offensive, and he talks to one of his engineers, John Bernard, and he asks him for a plan, and Bernard comes back and he says, well, you really need a column of 40,000 men in order to conduct an offensive like that right now, and I'm not sure we really have that. And he says, at present, everything is well enough, and Richmond must ultimately fall unless the course of things is changed by disaster, which would strengthen the hands of the Peace and Secession Party. And Lee at this time has Jubal Early, a force in the Shenandoah Valley that has basically been fighting against Philip Sheridan there for a while. Lee pushes Early to attack Sheridan. Lee thinks that Early outnumbers Sheridan, but Lee is wrong in this, but he continues throughout October to say you really need to attack Sheridan. Early does that. There's a battle at Cedar Creek on October 19th. does not go well at all for Early. He's essentially swept from the field. And this news of Cedar Creek comes to the headquarters at City Point, where Grant is. And this news appears to inspire Grant. And Grant decides, well, we're going to go ahead and launch an offensive here, even though it's the election's coming up in 2 weeks. He talks to Meade and says, what we want to do is take the last remaining rail line into Petersburg, the South Side Railroad, draw up a plan, see if you've got enough men to do it. Meade gets to work on this plan, which will be the Grant's sixth offensive at Petersburg. Now, Grant and Meade, it's an interesting relationship. They get along at this point. Things have been rocky through the year. Meade, he's the victor of Gettysburg. He's a steady, unremarkable leader. And after Gettysburg, his star kind of falls because the administration doesn't think he's aggressive enough. He's very unhappy. He writes in the fall, he says, in all successful operations, I was ignored. And the moment anything went wrong, I was held wholly responsible. And rather than continue in this way, I would prefer retiring. But Grant says, look, I'm happy with what you're doing. And if you want to see every dispatch I've sent to Washington, I can show it to you. So we get to the offensive. In the north, Butler's going to conduct a demonstration. He has two corps under his command. He's supposed to threaten the lines and make sure that Lee doesn't send a lot of men down to the south. The offensive occurs on Thursday, October 27th. Essentially, Butler does too much, and his subordinates do too much. They demonstrate, they fix the Confederates in place like they're supposed to, but they conduct several attacks that they just shouldn't conduct, and they lose a lot of men unnecessarily. To the south, this plan that Meade comes up with is essentially a three-pronged plan. He does manage to scrape up 40,000 men, so he's leaving very few men in the trenches for this offensive. The first prong is the Ninth Corps is to hit this Confederate line here called the Boyden Plank Road line that covers this road here. They're supposed to attack the trenches there. The Fifth Corps under Governor Warren is supposed to come up on the left flank of the Ninth Corps and also attack. The intelligence reports say that this is a relatively new trench line that the Confederates have dug, and the Union planners think that it's not very developed, that it's weak, and so they think they can push through and break through that line. The third part of the plan is to send the Second Corps under Winfield Hancock all the way around the Confederate right flank to gain a position on the South Side Railroad. The idea is to take these Union lines and create a continuous line that would essentially close off Petersburg. That's the plan. The cavalry under Gregg is to support Hancock. So there are two problems with this plan. I'm just going to give the punchline away for the sixth offensive here. One is that this line is not weak. It's in fact very, very strong. And the other issue is that the Union planners think this line actually ends down here at this pond over here. In fact, the line is forward about a mile and a half, and this makes things very difficult. This second prong here, the Fifth Corps under Warren, he kind of has this complicated contingent plan. If he gets here and can't break through, then he's supposed to go around, cross this Hatcher's Run, this stream here, come around the right flank, and hunt up a way to cross back across Hatcher's Run. It's kind of complicated, and it all kind of assumes that this line actually bends back that way. So those are the two problems. So in the morning of October 27th, you basically have the Ninth Corps hits this line. The Ninth Corps is delayed for some reason. It takes them several hours to get out of their trenches and march two miles, and they wait outside their trenches for some reason on the picket line for a couple of hours. They hit the line, they find that it's very, very strong, and they entrench. By this time in the war, the standard thing for troops to do when they stop in the field is to entrench. They don't wait for orders, they just get stuff out and they just start digging. The Fifth Corps does the same thing. Warren comes, he finds the same strength there, the trenches. He just stops, he trenches, the plan B goes into effect. Warren sends one of his divisions south of Hatcher's Run.
It's supposed to come up along this stream and find the Confederate right flank. This area turns out to be a jungle, you know, like a deciduous jungle, I guess. But it's just they cannot, they get lost. This division spends most of the day just kind of spinning around off of in these woods here. Now, for Hancock, the Second Corps, he makes it to this place called Burgess Farm here, just south of this pond, and he stops there given the lack of progress that's happening with the Ninth and the Fifth Corps. And so he's there on the Burgess Farm. Grant and Meade arrive with their staffs, and they meet at Hancock's field headquarters, and they talk about what they need to do. Grant says, I want to see what's happening for myself. And he gets on his horse, and he brings one aide, and comes down to Hatcher's Run here. The Confederates are just right across the stream here, Confederate cavalry and some infantry that have been being pushed back by Hancock all day. Grant gets to very close to Hatcher's Run. He's there in front of the picket line, and he wants to see, well, what's here? Can we send Hancock to the Southside Railroad, or should we just stop? While he's there, there's telegraph wire that has been cut down. It's all over the road. It gets all caught around the legs of his horse. His aide has to get down and untangle it. Grant's very concerned about the horse, and then he gets back on, calmly gets back on, and goes to the field headquarters. Well, when I saw this in my research, I just thought, well, this is one of those post-war things that's just kind of made up. But I found it in several contemporary accounts, and so I think it's true. Now, how calm he was, you know, who knows? But this is what, you know, Grant does. He's on the battlefield. He has the, unlike Lee, Lee is up north at Chaffin's Farm. He doesn't really know where the blow is going to land, so he's not commanding in person. But Grant can. Grant, with launching this offensive, he can go to the point, the spear point, and figure out what's going on. Well, Grant decides we're not going any farther today, and he calls off the offensive, but tells Hancock to stay at the Burgess Farm because Grant wants Lee to attack him. He wants the Confederates to attack him because he knows that by this time in the war, attacks generally don't go very well, and he has more men, and the more men, the more battles that he can have, the better. That's kind of his view. He at this point in the war, he is strictly against ordering his men to attack fortified positions. So this idea of Grant the Butcher, he's not doing this, particularly at this point of the war after the Overland Campaign. He's being very cautious about that sort of thing. And you see in his orders for this this particular operation, you know, do not attack men in trenches. But he does want to take a position and get the Confederates to attack him. Well, the Confederates don't disappoint. And even though the offensive is over by about 2 in the afternoon on this Thursday, the fighting isn't. And what happens is the Confederates, true to form throughout the campaign, they plan a counterattack. A division, William Mahone's division from the lines at Petersburg, are pulled out. Mahone is given a three-brigade striking column and is sent off to attack Hancock, who is at this point fairly isolated there south of Hatcher's Run. William Mahone, very interesting person. He's very short, very, very thin, unconventional dress. Sometimes he wore a Panama hat around the camp. 38 years old. He was in the railroad business before the war. When his wife learned that he had a flesh wound during the war, her response was, "Now I know it's serious, for William has no flesh whatever." As a combat leader, he often displayed a confident and quick mind. One of his contemporaries said, "Mahone was a man absolutely devoid of fear. He did the right thing as he saw it under all circumstances without regard to consequences. He could be arrogant, brusque, tactless in dealing with others." Someone described him as a tyrant and presumptuous dictator. Early in the war, from a military standpoint, he didn't have a lot of success at brigade command, but he really shines during the Petersburg campaign. He's familiar with the terrain. He actually surveyed a lot of the area before the war, and he was very successful. After the war, he ended up, he was a political reformer, and he led a black-white fusion party in Virginia known as the Readjusters, and which was very unusual for a Confederate veteran to do that kind of thing after the war. He did maintain his combative style, though. One of his contemporaries during his political career, I believe it was in the 80s, said, "Listen, the only way Mahone will bury the hatchet is in the heads of everyone who opposes him." So they conduct this attack. It hits the right flank of Hancock, and the Confederates do this throughout the campaign. There's an advance by the Union force, usually a corps size, and the Confederate attack comes around to the right flank of the Union force, basically getting between the Union force and their line of communication or line of supply. Here, Mahone crosses on a dam that has been constructed by Wade Hampton, who's the cavalry commander, by his troops. He slips somehow between Crawford's division, that division that's lost in the jungle, and he comes through on a little, there's a little, like a wood road that he comes through, bursts through the middle of Hancock's position, and essentially breaks Hancock's position in half. And it looks like a disaster. 2 weeks before the election, the Confederate counterattack has slipped through and has hit this Union corps that is isolated out way beyond the Confederate right flank. We have Hancock here. Winfield Hancock is head of the Second Corps. Now, the Second Corps for the Union, the Army of the Potomac, they're essentially kind of like throughout 1864, they've acted as the shock troops of Meade's army, particularly during the Overland campaign. But by the summer, they have lost so many men, their morale is so low, they start performing very poorly on several battlefields. So the Jerusalem Plank Road in June, the Weldon Railroad battles, Reams Station in August. And so there's a lot of concern about the, you know, the Second Corps. Is the Second Corps going to hold up in battle? Hancock, he was at Gettysburg. He might be familiar to many of you. He's intelligent and popular, a great leader, not a particularly great tactician, but he and his men really shine here. With Mahone having cut his position in two, he rallies his men. They reform. There's a lot of confusion. At one point, he comes up to a bunch of men, and he says, "You need to build a trench right here." And they say, "We don't have any shovels." He says, "Use 10 plates, canteens, sticks, anything, but throw up works." And they say, "Well, General, will you kindly tell us which side of the breastwork we're supposed to get on after we make it?" Because things are so turned around by this attack. Mahone, apparently, you know, according to the story, he smiles and rides off. So the Second Corps, this reaction to Mahone essentially crushes Mahone's brigades. Mahone has committed the Virginia Brigade and the North Carolina Brigade, these veteran units, and they essentially lose about half their men, most of them to prisoners in this attack, and Mahone retreats north of Hatcher's Run. Hancock stays in this position throughout the evening. A horrible rainstorm comes. So it's a miserable night for everyone. All these units are out on the battlefield or in the lines. A Wisconsin soldier writes home, and he says, "The next time you have a rainy night, just imagine you belong to the Army of the Potomac. Go out in the park, let the pile of wood that generally adorns the southwestern angle of the Capitol represent the breastwork, wrap yourself in a cavalry overcoat, and take a seat on the bare ground, your back against the end of the sticks of wood. And before the morning, if you are not picked up by the patrol as a lunatic or an inebriate, you will know how the night of October 27th was passed by a large portion of the Army of the Potomac." So Hancock pulls back within the lines. The Union forces don't gain any ground, and the offensive is over. So in many ways, it's a failure. It's not a spectacular failure, so it's not enough to really affect the election. And some of this is helped by some spinning that's done by Union officials afterwards. They kind of repackage the operation and they say, well, this wasn't really a full-blooded offensive. It was a reconnaissance in force. You know, we were just kind of checking things out. As we look beyond this to the end of the Petersburg campaign, Grant is riding off from the field. He's going back to headquarters and he discusses things with his staff, and he realizes that he needs to do something different. And according to one of his staffers, he says, it will be necessary for the Army to cut loose from its base, leaving only a small force at City Point, at the base and in front of Petersburg. The whole Army then can swing completely round to the left and make Lee's present position untenable. So he has a new plan, and this is grounded in what some people call a raiding strategy, where he breaks off a very large force into the interior and seeks results like that. Sherman does this during the Meridian campaign. He does this during the March to the Sea in Atlanta. Sherman and Grant are very much partners in their strategic operation tactical thinking. And so this is the idea that Grant uses, and he uses it in the spring at a place called Five Forks that is far to the west of Petersburg. A huge victory there for the Union. Shortly after that, Petersburg is taken and Richmond falls, and the war ends several weeks later. So that's all I have.
We hope you've enjoyed this edition of the Fairfax Scene. If you would like to view other history talks, visit our YouTube channel. For the Fairfax Scene, I'm Rachel Roth, and we'll see you next time.